I'm even more available on Slack since I don't have office hours this week.
So no office hours on Thursday at all?
No, there will be. So Tran will be, so that was another thing, right? Because office hours the Thursday before it's due, there are a lot of people. And I feel like it's, and I mean, I've been to machine learning office hours where there's so many people you barely get a question in. So we want two people, we're gonna have two TAs at that time slot so we can get to everyone. Because there's no point in having office hours, like she had two people in her office hours and we had 30 in mine. Right, I mean, that's just a waste of a TA earlier in the week. So we're gonna have two, but I'm gonna be gone. So just one this week and then next week. Okay, we're ready? Great. So, okay, so we're gonna step through. Today there's no, there isn't gonna be any JavaScript exercise. We're really just gonna go through the homework. But we're gonna take it a little slower because there was a lot in class today. It's the second week where you guys have been bombarded with a whole bunch of new stuff. So I really wanna take the time and talk about things that are common problems and what you can get messed up with and things like that. And we're gonna go back to some of these examples today to show what I mean. So, unlike homework two, we're not working with classes here. Okay, you're only editing the script.js file. So, and I have here the boilerplate of what you guys have been given. So we're gonna start checking out the HTML. None of this, at the very beginning, nothing's new, right? We have all the styles and the header. You guys don't have to mess with this, which means that at the moment, everything's already styled for you. And here we inserted the answers from homework one. So when you load your HTML, you're gonna see all of this already there, all the bars. But they're static, there's no interaction, and the whole point of this homework is to learn how to select, both using the native DOM API and the Java 3 API, to mess with it. Modify it, when you click a button, it does something, but the idea is we give you the SVG elements. Now, I'm gonna tell you right now, there's not a catch, but this is where everyone gets messed up with this homework. Unlike the homework you guys just turned in on Friday, there's already stuff in the DOM. So when you do a select, you're gonna grab the stuff, right? You're gonna modify it. So there's no messing with enter and exits right off the bat, because you're selecting everything. One of the parts of the homework, if you read the whole thing, is at one point we randomly subset the data, which means we will randomly give you less or more of the data. So you will have to deal with the exits and the enters at the very end of the homework. And that's where people usually get messed up, because their code works perfectly if there isn't a change in the size of the data. So this is the first homework where we are actively changing the size of the data every time you click a button. So that's where you really gotta pay attention. And I'm gonna go into more detail on that, but I just wanna really point that out, because that's where most people got messed up last year. Okay, so the structure being you have your HTML file that we just looked at, you have a script file, and you have your data.
Can you say boilerplate? What is that?
It just means like a skeleton. Like, hey, here's the stuff that we give you, build on top of this. So this is just like all that, I'm assuming at this point everyone's been able to get a server up and running, Windows, Mac, Linux, it works, right? Great. Okay, so the first thing is, and this relates, this is like pretty much exactly what we talked about in lecture today, so I'm actually gonna go back to one of the examples to show you. The first thing we're gonna do is if you go to your HTML, you'll see that we have, for a moment there, I thought I opened the solution. We have this select, right? So this is a drop-down menu. We have a checkbox, and we have a button, staircase. And if we open, so we have this button, we have this drop-down, and we have this checkbox, right? So the first thing we want you guys to do is to say, when you interact with any of these, we want you to call certain functions, okay? So these are pretty much events. If we go back to the lecture today, he was talking about events when you click on these buttons or when you click on a div, right?
Is this the DOM manipulation one or the?
The DOM manipulation one, which was the one he talked about today. Yeah, so if you guys want to navigate to this is lecture DOM manipulation about halfway through in the events part. So if you recall, he showed you two different ways of doing it, right? Say you want to link an event to a button. The first way of doing it is like this. So this means that you're in HTML and you're saying, here's my button. When I click on that button, get that function to run, right? That's one way. As he mentioned in class, that's not his preferred way. We accept this way. This is a valid way. I talked to him right before I came down to make sure. And then the other way of doing it is this one, where you don't have a direct reference. So your HTML has no reference to a function. And what you're going to do is inside your script, you're going to grab that button with the ID and set the on click. They do the same thing. Those are the two ways that you associate an event to an HTML button, or to an HTML checkbox, or to an HTML drop-down menu. Okay? So that's the first part of the homework. You can just pick one of these two ways and print it. Now, one thing that may not be entirely clear is the following, and this has happened when in the last homework lab I said, use the examples that he does in class for your homework. And while that is true, you may notice that the examples in class are very self-contained. They're the HTML, the style, and the script. And in the homework, we don't have a script tag. We have a script tag with a single file, but we don't have any script inside the HTML. Which means if you're going to do the approach where you're in the function, grabbing the button and adding it on click, you're going to do that where? Script.js. Right? And just to be very clear that that is just the idea of taking out the JavaScript from the HTML and putting it in a separate file. But it's the same concept. Your server, your whatever's serving your files is going to run that script. Okay. So hopefully that makes the first part trivial. Now, one thing that he didn't, is this from the very beginning, did he say this yet? Okay, so at this point you've just linked the functions to the checkboxes, but you have nothing implemented, right? So your functions are bare. So that's the next thing we're gonna do. There is a function called staircase inside the JavaScript file. Right? And that's the first thing you're gonna implement. So this is what's gonna run when you click that button. Staircase. And one thing I did which I thought would be helpful was I'm actually showing you the solution here so you can see what behavior we want. Okay? So what happens is, and I'm going to
reload this. Should both the graphs be aligned in the staircase
manner? No, and that's one of the reasons why I think it's really nice because sometimes we describe it and we get exactly these questions. This is the behavior we want. I'm showing you the solution. When you click staircase, we just care about one. We just want you to get the first one and make it a staircase. And the reason is we just want you to understand how you do that without the three. You have to grab it and then set its attributes, right? And that was another thing that Alex, sorry, just missed a sentence. That's another thing that Alex mentioned in class today, right? We can set the attributes two ways, with D3 or with the native API. And there's slightly different syntax, but it's the same concept. Grab the element, either D3 select or document get element, and then you set the attributes. And in this exercise, we want you to do it without D3. Grab this, and set the attributes so that it looks like a staircase. That's it. Right.
Are we sorting the previous rectangles that are already present, or are we just assigning the heights as we go? Because if you actually look at it, over here you have exactly 10 rectangles,
yeah,
and then the data we've got about 11 rectangles.
Really?
Yep.
So you have
10
rectangles, so
if you refresh,
11. I believe you said 8, 9, 10, 11. Oh, the reason is because the index starts at 0.
Oh.
And so if you're setting it as a function of the index, your first height is 0.
So you're assigning the heights.
You're assigning the heights as you go along, yes. Because you could sort it. The problem with sorting is that you're not going to get this even staircase, right? You're just going to get a sorted kind of junky thing. You want it to look like this.
Okay.
So you could sort it, but then it's not the highest, but then there's no point sorting, right? And honestly, you could end up with 11 and that would still be right. It's just that in this solution, because we use the index and we multiply it right, you get a 0. But if you end up doing multiply plus a delta so that it actually is 11, that's fine. It's really the concept that we want is that can you select and set attributes using the native API?
So basically, in this, we are sorting the heights and then reassigning.
No. You don't need to sort it because if you think about it, let's suppose these are the original ones, right? If you sort this, that means it's going to go from small to high, but it's not going to look like that.
It actually does look pretty nice. Something
it looks like this, yeah.
To the staircase.
Does it look that neat?
Yeah, it's looking
yeah, it
like
looks
this.
That neat, but it's a higher order.
In that case, it's fine. Yeah, we just don't want it to be, you're right, but maybe it just looks like they're different because they're out of order. If you sort it and they look close enough to this, that's fine. You know, that was it. Although, you know, the problem with that, though, is that you don't use the set attributes, and we do want you to use set attributes. So for everyone who's here and hear me now, set the height yourself of the bars. Because that's what we want to show you how to do. Yeah. So obviously that's a solution and no one's gonna say you lose points. But what I'm telling you is what we want you to do is to learn how to set the attributes. Because that's what you're gonna be doing with D3.
So
So for your fourth set, if you click on your fourth set, would it look, still look like that?
You mean in the menu?
Yeah.
In the drop down? No.
And then you hit staircase, what will happen?
Oh, I see what you're saying, yes.
Oh.
That's a good point. That's exactly why you can't just sort it. Thank you. That's a really good idea. Because with different data sets,
yeah.
If you sort it, then it's not going to look like a staircase anymore. It just happens to look like that in the first one.
So are we okay to sort it? Is it already sorted? No?
Well, if you already sort it, the problem is if you sort it and then you choose another one and then you hit staircase, it's not going to look like a staircase. If you think about it, it's just an extra step, right? I mean, honestly, the sorting, you don't really need the sorting. Just.
I spent time doing that.
Yeah.
Okay. Learning experience. Okay, so, but thanks for bringing that up. These are things that I haven't even considered, that you could sort instead of just setting the heights if you really want to set the heights. Okay, so that's the staircase part. Hopefully that's pretty explained. Then the next thing is the reshaping things with D3, right? So now let's look at what we already gave you so that you can understand. So this is the script.js. Before we go to update, let's go to right here. So I just want to explain what this code does, right? Because we gave it to you, but you kind of have to understand what it's doing. So d3.csv is loading in the CSV file and data. You don't have to worry about that. Remember in homework 2 when we gave you that boilerplate that had a little AJAX call that would get the data and load it in for you? That was really messy. This is what substitutes it. This is a D3 call that says, okay, you tell me what the file is, and I will give you back the neatly formatted data, just an array of data. Okay? And then we go through, we randomize. This is if we're going to do it. Remember there was a random checkbox? This is the part where we'll say, okay, I'm going to randomly subset this data. And what this does is it makes your initial set of 11 points now 3 or 4 or 5, because we want to test your ability to take elements and remove elements, add elements and remove elements from the screen. So that's what that's doing. And if it's not random, then we pretty much just call change data, which is just the simple call to d3.csv. Load in the data, call update. Yeah?
Up a few lines or has for the change data.
Yeah.
When it has CSV and then it has update in parentheses, what does that update mean?
So this is the callback function. So see how this replaces this. So the idea, the syntax for this is, I'm going to read in this file, and then what am I going to do with it? The second input to d3.csv is a function. And so we're saying, if you didn't check random, read in the data and call the update function, which you're going to implement.
Yeah.
And then if, one second. And then if you, and this is the case where you read it in, and then it has this anonymous function that will actually randomly subset.
Okay.
Kind of answered it where you just said that function is anonymous when you kind of
go. It would be the equivalent of having another function name and calling it there. But we only use it here and you're not implementing anything, so it's just easier if it's there. Okay, so that's pretty much what the these functions do. Now, one thing that we say here that we actually told you to do, and then I realized that I actually gave it to you with a boilerplate, was this idea that when you do, let me see where I say this, this idea of oh, it's later on. Okay, I'll bring it up later. Another thing, we didn't include, just so you could make sure that you understand the concept of including scripts, if you look at your homework, that HTML, there are no, hopefully, right? Are there any script tags? There's no script tags. Which means if you try to run your code, the HTML does not know the existence of your code, right? So it's very easy, just look back to homework 2 and homework 3, the concept being you need two things for this to work. The D3 library and your own script, right? So just make sure you add those script tags in the HTML file, and that's in the spec, but otherwise you're going to be running HTML, it's not going to work because it's not calling any functions. Okay, so that is this part right here. Okay, so the bulk of the assignment, and this is where you're going to spend most of your time, is inside script.js in this update function. Okay? And we gave you some things, and you're going to select and update other things. So, like Tim, you talked about a lot about scales in class today, because it's brand new, just being into the scales, but it's important that you understand what's going on here. So I'm just gonna take 2 seconds to go over that again. So the idea of the scales is, you guys remember from previous homeworks, that you had to manually take data and make it into pixels. You multiply, you add, you do whatever. So this is what it's gonna do for you, right? You're gonna say, hey, my data goes from zero to this maximum value, and I want the range, in other words, I want the output in pixels to be anywhere between 0 and 150. Not anywhere, meaning any, zero maps to 0, 150 maps to that. So it's pretty much a ruler that takes, so imagine a smaller ruler, that's your data range, and then a big ruler, that's your pixel range, and it just pretty much maps the equivalent value. So you say, okay, if my value is 2, I want pixels to be 100, if my value is 3, 300, and so forth. It does the math for you. So we gave you 3 different scales, an A scale, a B scale, and an I scale. And you're going to use this in the parts where you update the data.
Can you explain that D arrow D.I?
So this is an ES6 syntax. This means function D, return D.B. It's just a short syntax for a function and return value. And you're going to see more and more of this. When you first see it, it's a little uncomfortable, but afterwards it just looks neat and small, and especially if all you're doing is returning a value. You only can't use it when you have a larger function. Not that you can't, it just makes it a little less obvious if you have a function that does other things, right? So then you want a function, you want a name, and then it does all this and finish the function, so it's more enclosed and more formal. This is more of a short term.
So can we write the function logic like in a curly brace instead of d.k? If we had a logic behind returning the
value. Yes. So the only reason, this is the ultimate short term. See how there's no parentheses, there's no return, and there's no curly braces. Because this assumes there's one input argument and there's one return value. The moment you have two, you need parentheses, so di, for example, when you use the index. And the moment that you have any kind of logic, then you need curly braces, and then you need a return statement. Okay, so it's kind of varying degrees of verbosity. And then just so you know what this is doing, does anyone remember what this plus sign here does in the front?
It's an assignment.
Floating point value.
Yeah, it goes from string to number. We just want to make sure that when it reads it in, it doesn't know if it's a string or a number, right? It doesn't really recognize it. If you try to do math with it, JavaScript will try and coerce types. Remember when Alex talked about that in class? So here we're just making it very clear to our data. Guess what? This is a number. Make sure it's a floating point. Because otherwise, you can run into problems when you're trying to do a scale on a character instead of a number. So this ensures that this
matters. So if you had a value and you wanted to go to string, what would that?
There's a JavaScript num to string or something. I don't really care what this index is. So
it's an implicit function, right? It will convert automatically. It will pass automatically.
Pass to string.
Pass to string.
Yeah, it assumes it's a string, mm-hmm. and then here we'll press the number. But he was asking if you have a number and you want to make it into a string. Then there's a JavaScript, I don't remember exactly.
So it's not simple like a plus, like
no.
It is, okay.
No, that's the shorthand. There's no short term that I know of, not the ultimate. Also, this is just what we're calling inside. If you do a console.log of D, you'll see that the objects that we're giving have an A and a B. We're just making sure those are numbers. We're gonna use those when we draw our lines and our bars. So these are parts of the data that got loaded in. Right? So this is part of that CSV file. If you open up the CSV file, you'll see that. Okay, so let's go through what you need to do here. The first thing is in your update function, see if there's anything we missed up here. No, so you've implemented the staircase, you've done the events, and now you're gonna select and update A and B bar charts. Does anyone remember from the beginning of this homework spec? What is the action on the HTML page that is triggering this? Update to reflect what? Let me go back to the page here. Alright, so these are the ways that the user can interact with the page. You click a button, pick a menu from the drop down, or you can check the brand, right? What happens when you press the button, the staircase button?
On-click.
Right?
Run staircase.
You get the staircase, right? That's the interaction with that. It's the on-click concept, yes. What happens when you select something from the menu?
Should update.
It updates the bars. So when we were talking about setting events to mapping the events, the functions to the HTML elements, that triggers the staircase function. Changing any of these, I don't know why I'm pointing up there when I have a mouse and a computer in front of me. This will update the bars. And this, and we'll get to that in a minute. So this is what you're going to be linking to update. So every time you change this, your update function is going to be called, right? The first thing you might assume when you look at this is what changes with each menu. We've taken care of that for you. You don't have to, every time you just click a different one, it goes in and grabs the right CSV file. If you look at your data, you have four CSV files. You don't have to worry about that. All you have to do is get the bars associated to the data and set the heights. So this is very, it's not much more complex than we've done so far. One thing that people usually get a little scared, not scared, but they think their code is wrong, what seems to be broken here?
The first
plot seems not to be changing, right? So people spend all this time trying to figure out what's wrong with it, and then they select the fourth one, and it changes. Why is that? Yes, and if you don't realize that, you think you're doing something wrong, and you're doing exactly the same thing for X and Y, and you keep banging your head. The first one doesn't change from the first three, it changes from the fourth one. Okay? So notice that everything changes. So that's the right now the update is you're going to do the same thing for bars as you do for the lines of the area chart. So this is very similar to what you've done in Org 2, but instead of doing nodes and edges, you're going to go back to bars and lines. Okay? And that is what you're going to do with these, and then the scattered points. Now, one thing that's happening here, we give you a line generator. Did you talk about the line generator? Do you talk about path generators? I was there and I don't remember anymore. So the idea here being, can we use d3.line for
homework?
What?
We didn't have d3.line. We had but that was an element that's
you drew out the line, you didn't call the 3.line, that's right. And then last homework for the edges, you guys used d3.line. Right? We used line elements. How did you guys draw lines for the node, for that node graph?
D3.line.
Okay, so even if people don't remember, that's perfectly fine. I just want to see if this is the first time you've been exposed to it. So the idea being you're gonna give this data and it's gonna return a path as a function of your x and your y. Okay? So the idea is this is a path generator. It's actually going to output that really obnoxious thing that you guys wrote in homework 1, which is ML10, you know, that horrible thing that you don't ever have to do again. It pretty much just draws it out for you. You just have to tell it, you say, I want a line, d3.line, and my x value as a function of the data is going to be the I scale, the y value as a function of data is going to be the A scale. Okay? Why? Anyone have any idea why it's called an I scale? Not that it matters, I'm just wondering if you guys...
Iteration.
Yeah, I think
zero,
you're right.
0 to 1, first,
yeah.
1 second.
Because I is the index, and that's what we're using as a proxy for x, right? Every bar, you move at over one element, you move over one. So it is the x scale, but we're using the I value to determine that. Okay. And then the A value is because the A bar is an A value, and the B bar is the B value. Okay?
So is it a line generator that you would do like all your attributes on?
Can you repeat the question? So you use the line generator, but you're wondering like if that's your data?
No, is that your actual line? So for instance, you have recs, right? Mm-hmm. And you do all your attributes on your recs?
Yeah.
Is that what a line generator is now?
No, that is what is going to go into the D attribute. Yeah, when you have a path, we need to give it a D attribute. That is what the actual line drawing is. So your D attribute is going to be that. I'm trying to remember D. There were there any examples of it? Did we not talk about lines? We definitely did not talk about lines here. Oh, do you know what we're going to do? We're releasing the solution to homework 2, and that has a line for the edges. So you can always look at that as kind of a reference.
Okay. Is that going to be released tonight?
Yeah, I can. We haven't done it, not because it's just sitting there. Okay, so that is how you do the line and the area. You just use those two examples and you update it when you change the menu. This is, I'm sure, second nature to you by now. Adding IDs make it much, much easier to select things. And this is very important because a common thing that happens is that people will do a select all rect. What happens if you do a select all rect?
Select even the second.
On this.
Select even the second.
Select even the second.
Yeah. Both of them are selected. So what happens is only this updates and that one doesn't. Right? And that's a very understandable mistake. But it's really to be able to understand, first you want to select the smallest possible parent, and then you do a select all rect. We're so used to doing these super simple examples where you have three rectangles and three data points, and oh, it works. The moment you have one data set associated to this, and another data set associated to this, you want to make sure that you put IDs so you can handle them differently. This is the A data, that's the B data. Okay, so that's pretty much the update part. Updating the scatter plot part of it is very similar to that JavaScript exercise that we did with circles. Right? You're selecting all the circles and you're setting CX and CY and that kind of stuff. Okay. Okay, so the next part is we are going to make it so that when you hover over these bars, see how they change color? Now this we want you to use not using V3. For this you're going to use the DOM API. So if you go back to the description. And this is something that someone might drop this here. Asked Alex if we were meeting today. And
couldn't you do this in the CSS?
Huh?
Is that what you want to do?
Don't do it.
Okay.
And what he means by that is there is a CSS called a selector called hover.
Right.
So if you put circle, colon, hover, whatever, and you put color green, when you hover on it, it gets green, which seems like an easy solution.
Right.
The drawback to that is all you can do is change the color. You can't, for example, trigger something else. When you do it with the JavaScript API or with D3, you have the control of saying unclick, change the color, call this other event, call my mother, do whatever you want to do, and not just this one stylistic thing. So it's the concept of being able to have more control over what happens when a user hovers. Okay? And this is where we're saying using JavaScript. I know we're going to get a lot of these questions. Our solution uses the native API, the DOM API. However, D3 is also JavaScript. I'm sure someone's going to use D3. We're not going to take away points. But the idea here is to...
There's a function called norms over.
Yeah. So that is something that you...
Can you use that?
You can use that. I should clarify with him if he cares if you use actually the native API or not. I'll put an announcement out. I'll ask him. So for now, just use whichever one you're most comfortable with. The idea being select the element, and then either using the native API, the DOM API, or using D3, make sure that when you hover, it changes the color. Okay? So you're either going to do it with the set attribute of the native API, or you're going to do it with the attribute dot attribute of D3. Either one is going to change the way it looks. Okay, and then this is the other thing, which is when you click on these points, we want, and hopefully the solution has it. Yeah, there we go. When you click on a point, any other scatter plots, we want to see what the A and B are. Now, someone asked on Slack, do you want to see the data or do you want to see the pixel value? In other words, do you want to see the original AB from the data that's bound to that circle? Or do you want to see what pixel position did it end up at? I said pixel. 2 seconds later, Alex said, I disagree. Native one doesn't matter. The point is, you want to know you can access the data. And the difference being, either you plot either you console.log the data directly, or you put it through the scale and console.log that, right? And that's the data versus pixel transformation.
Anyone can work.
Either one of them is fine. Yeah. It's almost like the pixel one is harder, is one extra step, right? So if you do that one, that means obviously you can do the first one. Yeah.
Are there any of jQuery's in that one?
Not at all. Like, don't even think about it. jQuery was so 2011. No, we're way past that. Okay. And so this is a note that that you were asking me about before, and that actually we accidentally gave you. So when you first load the page, we haven't called update, right? What you're seeing is just what was in the HTML. It's the SVGs that we hard-coded in, which means we haven't bound any events, we don't have any functions linked to it, which means there should be no interaction. So that's what we're saying, that even after you, if you fill out the update function, it's not gonna work until you actually update the page, because that's when it binds the events to the SVG elements. So what you had to do, which we accidentally did for you, is, and I'll show you, is this right here. What this means is, okay, so you have the whole body, now just call the change data. And all the change data is going to do is check which one is selected and run on your JavaScript, which binds all the event listeners, so you won't have that problem. Okay. So the first extra credit is, instead of just doing a console.log on the x and y values of it, just do a tooltip. Now that was one of the questions on the Slack channel, is what is a tooltip? So even though we're not going to give this much guidance because it's extra credit, what it means is we want you to mouse over it and a nice little div will show up. And I say div, but you don't use a div. Just a nice little square that shows you what the scatter plot values are, what the circles are. And we suggest that you use the HTML title attribute. It makes your life much easier. It's actually pretty straightforward. Okay, part five is where I want you to save all of your time, because this is where you're gonna get stuck. This is where the enter, exit, update is really gonna, we're really gonna test you on that. So if you feel like, oh, this is really easy, I'm gonna wait until the last minute, don't, because this is the part, and this is where I wanna give you pointers so that you don't get stuck. So this is what's gonna happen. When you click on random subset, it will randomly give you less than the full data. And so what we're doing is we're saying, hey, you know that update thing that you did when we select a different one here? We also want you to handle the fact that sometimes we're giving you 11 points, sometimes we're giving you 3, sometimes we're giving you 7. Okay? And all that really means is what we've been saying ever since we started with D3, be very careful where you're appending, and where you're styling, and where you're removing. And don't forget to merge. That in itself is the recipe for success. Only append to the end of selection. Make sure to merge your enter and your update selection. Style your merge selection. That's it, you won't have any problems. Because if you append to your select, what's gonna happen? You have bars on top of bars on top of bars, right? Because you selected the 7 that are here, and then you get new data, and you append a rect to every one of these. Now you have 14, and you don't understand why they're not going away. That gets messed up. So as long as you have those things clear in your head, then it should be fine. Because we're the ones who are handling the fact that when we do a dot random, when we do a random subset, that we give you a smaller portion of the data. And for you to see that in action, just click and unclick the random one, and then do a console.log of the data coming in. And you're gonna see that sometimes it's larger, sometimes it's smaller, okay? Now, one thing that we say here, and I'd really like to know if this makes sense to you, is the following. So your next task is remove and add elements, like we were just saying. This here, does this make sense to anyone? You only need to add code reshaped to the charts. The scatter plot, the line and area charts should handle different data sizes. Why are lines and area charts handling these and bars aren't? And I'll open up this so you can stare at it for a second before I tell you. Just give everyone some, just a minute, but yeah, then I will tell you. If you think you have an idea, just raise your hand, just have an idea. Okay, do you want to tell me what you think it is?
It's because for the bar and the line, we have each of them as a shape, and for the bar we have each of them as a shape, and for the line and the area, someone has to be a shape. You're drawing a path like you mentioned.
That's
right?
Exactly what it is.
So you're not exactly appending and deleting paths.
Exactly. So that is an important distinction, just to understand why it is that we said that. So what he said, with the bars, we have a separate rect for each of our data elements, right? So the enter and the update and the exit becomes really important. with a line, if you remember back to homework one, we had one line element per segment, right? That was when we did line x1, x2, line x1, x2. Then the other one was a path. And do you remember that unlike the line, 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 the path was one single path? And that path took into account all of the data because the xy, our line generator says, okay, so your first data point is here, your second point is here, but if you, and let's see if I manage to inspect this properly. That is one path element. It's one SVG element that takes into account all of your data. So what happens if you have more data points? It's still one path, but just has more XYs. And who's taking care of that? What is the function that takes care of that? The line generator. Just like the area generator. So that kind of encapsulates this idea of growing and expanding because you're not putting more elements, you're just growing this one element. Okay? You were gonna ask something?
No, I was just saying, you asked who handles that because you basically handle it for it.
Well, it's not even the, what we handle because we give you the line generator. Yes, but the line generator is the one that's conceptually different than one SVG per data. Okay? So then this is the idea where every time you do the checkbox, it will send a smaller data set to the update function, and then you need to go through and make sure you remove the extra ones, merge the existing with an enter, only append to the new ones, and style them, okay? Is anyone here not clear on the steps that you take?
Can you just repeat it one more time?
Yeah,
the
absolutely.
The exit and enter.
So when you select everything, right, if you have the same number of data as you have elements, and actually this is that. Let me just see if any part of the I think that the best way of actually remembering this is he had a really good example, so you can always go back here almost to kind of copy it. Let's do a search for merge. This is the idea, right? Right here. Select all bars. What is inside bars?
All the elements that are on the bar elements.
All the bar elements that are on your DOM at a given point, right? What is bars.exit?
If we have less than the number of.
So this is gonna really be important when we do a subset because we're gonna give you less data, which means you don't have leftover recs on your screen. So if you don't have this one line, they don't go away. Okay? Then we have the idea that we have. Then we have bars that enter. What's that?
Yeah.
The opposite. You click random again, and this time it gave you more elements, and now you have enter. And this is the idea. Remember last class I was saying that you always want to have a line for exit and for enter? Because of this, you're not going to control how much data comes in. So it handles both cases. You have too much data, we'll get rid of it for you. You have not enough data, we'll enter and append it for you. Okay? And then this right here is crucial. If you forget this dot merge, then there's no way you can style both of them without having a repeat block of code. So you need to make sure that you merge the enter selection with the existing selection. Once you've merged it, then you do your setting of attributes. Okay? So this is just the step-by-step of what you need to do to make sure that your bar is updated correctly.
So no matter what, we always keep the sequence. Exit, enter, and then the attributes.
Yes, that is true. Now, one thing that you'll notice in his examples, and this is even something that before we got to this point, is you'll see examples where all he does is select all and then sets the attributes. And that will work for the simple examples, but now that we're getting into this varying number of data, so people will copy these simple examples from earlier and wonder why it doesn't work, which is why I really want to iterate that you need all the steps. And one thing I said last, I don't know if anyone noticed this, so the last homework, someone asked me, I think it was, you better remember who it was, I'm sitting up here, can you have an exit and enter at the same time? And I very adamantly said, nobody was paying attention. No, you can't. Because you either have too many, or you don't have enough. And then someone asked that in class, and Alex said, yeah, you can. So afterwards, I went to talk to him, and I realized that he is right, and that's what he talked about today in class. Do you guys remember this idea of a key function that he talked about? So right now, we're just saying, hey, these are the rectangles, these are the data, D3, do your thing and join them. We don't necessarily say, this data goes with this rect. This element goes with this rect. So if you look at the, search here for key. is an example where we can have an exit and an enter. I just want to reiterate that so you don't be thinking you never have those. Of course, your beautifully written code handles both, so it doesn't matter. But conceptually, I just want you to understand that before we had dot data, data, right? Now we have a dot data and a function that says, do you know what I want to identify this? I want to identify this data point as the d dot product. So now we're linking that data point to that SVG specifically. And if we have a new data point that has a different d dot product, we remove this one because it was linked to this one, and we bring in a new one. So we kind of marry the data points to the SVG more than just saying randomly assign them. Without the key function, D3 will just change the ones that are there. With the key function, it will delete the ones that have been used and bring in new ones. If this doesn't make sense, it doesn't matter. Just take my word for it that sometimes you have enter and update. Enter and exit selections if you have key function. Which you don't in this homework, so you can ignore the last 5 minutes.
One question.
Yeah.
So here we are selecting all the bar view elements, and then we are calling the function the parameter D as the name of the product. So how is it actually mapping the data with the element? Because
it's still doing the same thing that that data does. It's just one extra level where we say, don't only associate this A data point to A group, associate it and then give it this ID. It's almost like giving it a dot ID. Like you're giving it a name. This is behind the scenes with D3. And the reason that it does that is so that when you update the data, you want that same bar to move and not things flying all over the screen. So you pretty much say, okay, now I updated the data, and remember that the one that was called fruit is still this bar, so update this height, and don't just give it a random new rectangle. It's more of a...
But that's happening in runtime, and we don't have a handle on the ID that's compiler is generating, right? I mean, how do we know like which ID along if we were to manipulate
to which one is specifically
right,
you don't?
We can't.
No. Okay. So yeah, once you have that, so once you handle all these different selections, you'll be fine. And then the last extra credit is adding transitions, which is what he was talking about at the end, which is also pretty straightforward. You can use the examples you used in class to just apply those and have your bars smoothly change up as opposed to just jumping up and down. I don't think we applied. I don't think we did any of the extra credits here. Yeah, see how it just jumps? Yeah, so we've been doing a lot of that. Random. So hopefully it's not daunting. Hopefully it maps really well to the stuff that we talked about in class. Use the examples from class to understand the concept of what it is that you need to do. It's not a hard homework, but people get stuck on little things like selecting all the rents, not merging them and not understanding. Making sure you exit just in the same order that you did in class. There's no real catch here. Okay, this is probably easier than last homework because there's less of a jump in terms of skills. Yeah.
So you explained what a line generator is.
Yeah.
Can you explain how you use it?
Yeah, so that was hopefully something you guys did homework too, which is what I'm going to do is release the solution.
Because when you actually do dot data for the line chart, you're going to actually end up having like, if you try to do enter, it's going to create 10 different elements, right? 10 different nodes. Because you have only one line in your SVG.
Right. So this is what, and honestly, these are like the most, this is what I was saying to Jerry, and I heard to Corey that. That application, I get new words of the day for 2 years now. And this is just something I want to show you because as you go forward, especially with the projects and stuff, your best friend is going to be this. Their documentation has examples, you can find. So when you want to learn how to use something that maybe we haven't covered, and Alex is a big fan of this, and I kind of understand, is that, you know, we kind of give you the concepts, and then maybe even if there's something we didn't give an exact example of, but the idea being, because we're giving you line, D3 has so many different path generators. The moment you're going to do an arc or anything else, you're going to have to go and look up how to do it. So this is like, they have these very, very detailed examples. Go to the API, D3 version 4 API, over to version 3, and just look at the examples of how they do it. Okay. And then if something's not clear, then ask that slide.
And are the generators also over here, or generators something that you guys made?
No, that is a D3 function. I mean, that specific one, we use the D3.line is the generator.
So, no, I mean, when you do let a line generator equals so and so.
We wrote that.
Yeah, how do you use the line generator? Is it a function? Is it a variable? Like, how do you use it for?
So, this is what this example is going to show.
Okay.
Okay. Any other questions? Does it seem doable? I was hoping for more resounding. Yes.
Yes.
Okay. I guess that's it. We will release the homework 2 solution. We will, you guys have your grade tomorrow, one, that's probably right. We'll be grading homework 2 this week.